Smile, you son of a...
Oh, hey everyone! Did you ever ask yourself, what is it that made sharks so darn scary? You know, other than, of course, the combination of being the perfect visible example of a big bad with lots of teeth, mixed with deep social misunderstanding. Well, turns out, it's important to think about, and can actually translate directly to good game design. Why is it that some games hold our attention longer than others, even if they all have gorgeous graphics, stirring stories, great gameplay, and marvelous music? Why is it that some games are just more exciting and able to lure us back again and again? Well, one of the secrets lies in two elements of what Psychology 101 calls operant conditioning, the two elements of which being variable ratio reinforcement schedules and variable interval reinforcement schedules. And the go-to guy who popularized operant conditioning in the 1930s was a Harvard professor named B.F. Skinner. And that name probably rings a bell because he's the number one bell-ringing, pellet-dropping inventor of the Skinner box, where rats were taught to hit a lever on a box to score a treat. Now, cut to today, and really the most forward-facing example of variable reinforcement in gaming is another kind of box.
One which shall not be named.
But we're not going to talk about those today, because really they're just the low-hanging fruit loot of Skinner's principles that more often than not just cater to bite-sized microtransactions. Instead, we want to specifically talk about how those same mechanics can be used for gameplay experiences rather than just making a quick buck. The difference is context. We can use these principles to keep our gameplay fresh and our players engaged, and that's because variable reinforcement can easily occur naturally within the world and story of our games. So while Skinner's original research was focused on granting or withholding rewards for behavior, what we're interested in as game designers is how that behavior affects expectation. For instance, if we know that every bag of coins we find in a game will always have three coins inside, scoring these bags again and again will quickly become less and less exciting. It's a feeling kind of akin to peeking at your presents before Christmas morning, because if you already know what's inside, the excitement in the act of opening them is diminished, and that eager feeling of mystery is gone. On the other hand, if the game used variable ratio reinforcement in these cases, that would mean that the amount of gold in any given bag could be 3 coins, or 5, or 1, or a bonanza of 10 coins, and a pair of magical perpetually clean socks. Jackpot! And it's that very uncertainty that keeps the expectation alive. And therefore, in many cases, games that vary the size of a reward that players receive tend to keep the act of hunting for and receiving those rewards feeling fresher longer. In Dishonored, for instance, in addition to the usual loot, like gold, there are also additional collectible items to give players a nice woe moment every now and then. Wait, where was I? Oh yeah. Now we come to the second cool thing, variable interval reinforcement. And here's where also our favorite misunderstood fish returns. One of the reasons that Jaws is so nerve-wracking as a concept is that he doesn't bite on a schedule. We don't know when he'll suddenly emerge from the depths and attack. His potential victims are all vulnerable, all of the time, turning each attack into a pretty big jump scare. And what survival horror game could be complete without a few good jump scares? But if there's a zombie in every closet of that house you really shouldn't have gone into anyway, pretty soon, what should be a surprising tense situation turns into a conveyor belt of just hacking and slashing. Instead, try varying your schedule of zombie jumping, have some closets with loot, or maybe throw in a fake jump scare every now and then. Just please, no more screeching cats. We've seen that plenty. Also, how do all these cats get in closed lockers without opposable thumbs? Okay, seriously, what are you all looking at? Is the tub leaking or something? Whatever. Okay, conveyor belts, cats. Oh, yeah, I remember. So if your player is clearing a neighborhood of the undead, having their occurrence rate vary will always instill a sense of anticipation. No matter if we're talking about attacks from zombies, sharks, zombie sharks, or even just shaking trees in Animal Crossing to find new furniture, it's the lack of scheduled outcomes that keeps us coming back for more. So whether you're making big MMORPGs or simply the cunning dungeon master of a tabletop game, give both variable interval reinforcement and variable ratio reinforcement a try, because they can provide the 1-2 punch of expectation and surprise that will keep your players enjoying your game for the long haul. But before we go, here's one last demonstration of our super reinforcement duo in action. Okay, I'm gonna step into this bathtub, and you're going to have to pretend really hard that there could be a shark in here. Because I mean, how could there be? I said, how could there be? How could there be? Oh, come on, that was your cue. Huh? Wait, Zoe, if you're out there, then what is... Oh, no. Oh, all right. Well, looks like I've jumped the shark. No, was that too much? Was that... No, now you're leaving? Wait, now, audience, you're not gonna... Really? Oh. I thought it was pretty funny.
Jumping the shark.
Legendary thanks to Ahmed Ziad Turk, Alicia Bramble, Casey Mustia, Dominic Valenciana, Gunnar Clovis, Kyle Murgatroyd, and O'Reels One for helping to make this show possible.